You want to go out, but you can't find your phone. What do? You get someone to call it. Aha! There it is. I'm an idiot. But how exactly does your brain figure that out? Because your eyes have kind of got it easy. Light bounces off everything you can see, and it hits your retina in the same shape as the scene in front of you. So if you can see your phone, you kind of automatically know where it is relative to everything else. But to hear where something is, all you've got is sound waves, concentric ripples in the air coming from somewhere out there in 3D space. Now, even if we collapse it into 2D, it's as if, and I've stolen this analogy from a Canadian psychologist called Al Bregman, there's a great big lake. And out on the lake, there are boats and ducks and jet skis. And you've got two tiny little channels coming off the lake. Those are your ear canals. And based just on the waves going up and down in those little channels, your brain can figure out where all the boats are, and the ducks, and the mobile phones. How do we even start? Well, to begin with, if a sound is, say, over on your left, it'll be louder in your left ear than in your right. And that's because your head's in the way. There's a sound shadow, which makes a level difference between your two ears. Much louder if the sound's way over here, then there's a gradient round, and it's even in the middle, and then louder on the other side. And that's really useful for high frequency sounds. But at low frequencies, the waves in the air bend more around your head. And that means that the level difference isn't nearly as big. So, for low frequencies, your brain still compares the two ears, but this time, it uses the fact that a sound, say from over there this time, reaches this ear just slightly sooner than this one. It's a timing difference. And even for a sound that's all the way around here, at 90 degrees, it's only a teeny tiny 5 or 6 milliseconds. So your brain has to be really precise with those signals. Now, we've got timing differences for low frequency sounds and level differences for high frequency sounds. But actually, nearly everything you hear is a mishmash of high and low, so your brain normally uses both of those cues. Let's try them out. This bit will work better if you put on some headphones. Now, this is what it sounds like if we make my voice slightly louder in your right ear. It's as if I'm kind of on your right-hand side. On the other hand, if we make the levels normal again, and then make the sound come just slightly a few milliseconds sooner in your left ear, then it's as if, not exactly, I'm kind of on your left-hand side. Now, neither of those is perfect, and that's because, like I said, your brain really wants to use both of those bits of information to tell where a sound is coming from. But even if we change both of them at the same time, it still doesn't sound quite right. And that's because there are other factors going on as well, including these guys. Not just decorations. What they do is filter the shape of the sound, a little bit like those graphic equalizers we all had in the 90s. Now that filtering helps us figure out sounds that are up here, or down there, or in front, or behind, when comparing the two ears doesn't make any difference. And if you think these are cool, barn owls have special ruffs of sound-reflecting feathers that are asymmetrical and which actually slow down the sound waves on their way into the ears so they can make much more of those differences. And they can pinpoint dinner, squeaking or rustling at 20 paces in the dark. I'll give your ears a rest now. But for more sound science, check out James May on noise-cancelling headphones. And for a regular dose of multisensory stimulation, subscribe to Head Squeeze. Now, where's my phone?